Welcome to the Open Apple podcast, where we celebrate the Apple II. Whether you're a long-time user, a nostalgic visitor, or a newcomer to the community, join us as we share news and memories of Steve Wozniak's most famous personal computer.
It's Friday, July 22nd, 2016, and we are live from Kansas Fest at Rockhurst University in Kansas City, Missouri. Featuring today the voices of every retro computing podcast that matters. By our powers combined, we are the How-To Retro History of Open Chicken Missile Antics Roundtable. We are here, as I said, recording from Kansas Fest, and we are going to go around the room and introduce ourselves, because some voices may be familiar for those of you who listen to all the shows, as well you should be. By the end of this show, you should be as well. But let's start with me. My name is Ken Gagne, and I am an occasional co-host of the Retro Computing Roundtable, as well as host of IndieCider and Polygamer, which have nothing to do with the Apple II. Going to my left and going clockwise, which is meaningful for those of you who are listening at home, is Kevin Savitz. Hi, Kevin.
Hi, I'm Kevin Savitz. I'm one third of Antic, the Atari 8-bit podcast, where I interview way too many people who did things with Atari computers.
Hi, I'm Rob McMullen. I'm with the Player Missile podcast, and I talk about computer magazines and Atari computer games.
Hi, I'm Mike Mulhern from the Retro Computing Roundtable. We're not hiding in the 8-bit bunker in Sydney. I'm enjoying myself over here in the USA.
I'm John Leake with the Retro Metcast.
I'm Kevin Savitz. Todd Jones with the Chicken Lips Radio podcast. Commodore, represent.
I'm Charles Mangan from the How To podcast.
I'm Jeff Salzman, the better half of History of Personal Computing.
I'm Quinn Dunkey, and I'm still stuck on Chicken Missile. but also co-host of the Open Apple podcast.
I'm Carrington Vanston, and I am a force of personality, and very happy to be here on Chicken Missile.
And we now know how old you are.
Yes.
By the rings.
And I'm Paul Hagstrom. I am often host on Retro Computing Roundtable, and also half of Drop 3 Inches.
So although we do have many podcasts and many interests among us, the binding force, the glue, if you will, is, of course, the Apple II computer, invented by Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak back in 1977.
I'm sorry, what and who?
I see Atari and Commodore.
Who all those things?
Worst romper room ever.
Oh, that's okay.
Commodore's
same font.
It's different.
I thought they stole the font. I thought Commodore stole the font.
Oh, it's true, they didn't.
Where are the rails? Missed. Rob is wearing a wonderful blue shirt with the Ready logo, the Ready prompt, the basic Ready prompt from Atari on it. And we can tell because it just says Ready, not Ready with a period.
Because if it was a Commodore, it'd say Waiting.
Only if you're loading from disk.
And so the trash talk begins.
We can continue.
They didn't turn up.
Because this is a fashionista show. Sure, why not? So we are here for the 28th annual Apple II convention, known as Kansas Fest, which is being held in the middle of the Midwest in the middle of July, a great decision that somebody made 27 years ago, which we have since inherited. So we started here on Tuesday, we started rolling in like we do every year, we checked in, we went out for dinner, the keynote was on Wednesday, and who was the keynote speaker, everybody?
Mike Harvey. Thank you.
Retro Compute.
Mike Harvey of Nibble Magazine. Formerly had the founding editor, David Satella, back in 2007, and this year Mike Harvey, the publisher for the entirety of the magazine's 12-year run, a dozen years. Great. We had hit with Mike Harvey as the keynote, and then we've had session after session after session, and we have one more full day here. And then we're going to go home and wait for next year until Kansas Fest 2017 occurs on July 18th to 23rd will be the 29th annual Kansas Fest. I also noticed people here passing notes. I can't wait to find out what surprises you have planned.
Is July high school after June?
Yes.
So I know which month that is.
You have May, June, and July.
Got it.
And also
thank you.
Three teams.
Some in my eyes.
Yes. Fucker and fuckatash. So, since we are all here for Kansas Fest, I had the brilliant idea, this was certainly not handed to me by Kevin, who wrote up the outline for the show, that we would talk about what is the most interesting thing that happened to us this week at Kansas Fest, or what's the most interesting thing you observed? What do you find fascinating about this Kansas Fest that makes it unique in your history? At least three of you have never been to KFest before. By three, I mean two. Since Charles has his face down right now, I couldn't see who it was.
What face are we counting?
pick a base. All your base. So let's start to my right. Let's go with Paul. Paul, what has made your Kansas Fest one for the books?
Oh, I get to go first, so I can mention Mark's talk, which was great.
Mark, who?
You stole mine.
I know. I'm so pleased that I got to go first. But yeah, no. Mark Pilgrim gave a phenomenal talk about software preservation and this program that he wrote that will auto-crack things and allow us to preserve things and know if our images worked. And it's everybody should go watch the video of that when you're done listening to this podcast, or pause now. They are going to make the video available. It was well presented, and it's a fantastic work.
It was also live on Facebook video. Yeah, I don't know if those are archived or not, but it may not be the best quality, but that'll be available immediately.
Right.
So you're referring to the program Passport.
Yes.
And he's already beta tested it on what, 3,000
images?
Yes.
It's a super. I mean, no need to completely rehash the talk here, but it was super impressive. Super impressive. Very interesting presentation as well.
So only when he cracked a new piece of software unpreserved on the stage.
Yeah. He's like, I just have been handed this floppy and I'm going to crack it
with one
right now.
Keystroke.
Yeah. And I hit C and it's cracked.
45 seconds later, it was done. And
yeah.
I mean, you're not supposed to demo something you've never done before. You just trusted a software and it worked. It's awesome.
Not to mention that it was technically probably illegal. Copyright infringement, etc.
Not your own witnesses.
That's true.
Yeah, rim to heaven.
And the program Passport is now available for download from archive.org. So that's a pretty quick turnaround. No teasers. This is just bam, it's done. It's out now.
So you're cracking it.
Carrington. We're just going
to
ignore that and roll right on to Carrington.
I come here for the people.
People!
Woo! It's people!
Kansas Fest is people!
I am going to pick a session as well, I think. And for me, it was the surprise release of Ancient Legends. Mm-hmm. So Lawless Legends group has been exploding our brains and teasing us with something amazing that's coming soon and is awesome, awesome, awesome looking. And in typical Martin Hay fashion, he begins a session by saying, I want to set expectations. Lawless Legends is not ready to release. We're going to have nothing come out this year. We just have a small update. We've been working as we can. And he ends the session by casually mentioning, oh yeah, we did throw together an entire other RPG, and it's amazing. It's completely done, and we're releasing right now, and here are 5 copies in my hand. So that's just how Martin rolls.
And here's the GitHub link.
Which appeared live during his session.
Yes. Right.
So it was fantastic. It was impressive. Everything the Lawless Legends people are doing is just exploding my brain. It's amazing. And the fact that Ancient Legends is out as a working game is almost like a little teaser kind of for what Lawless Legends will be. But an amazing game in its own right is what it looks like. Very exciting. And I got copy number one. Suck it. So that was also pretty cool.
There was some sort of contest that
which I won.
Right.
See, suck it above.
So what was the name of the tree?
Root Guard.
So
the idea was, if you could name the giant tree, which is a character in the game, you play through the game, get to the tree, you could, if you could name it, you would get one of the 5 not-to-be-duplicated original copies that were, of course, copy protected. That's how he's going to roll, which is great.
And Passport failed to deprotect.
Right. And in true Kansas Fest fashion, of course, what I did was just download the source from GitHub and step through it looking for the names of the characters. Go, no, I'm not playing your game. Here is it. 20 seconds later, that's the name. Give me my phone.
Nice.
So that's how I rolled. It was great. So I'm very happy to have that. I'm excited to play it. And so that's my choice for thing that knocked my socks off this week so far.
Thanks, Carrington.
You're welcome, Ken.
Wow, that's so sarcastic.
Not yet.
That is cheating.
Are you done?
Yeah.
Are you finished?
Nope. send his mix.
You Canadians, honestly. Learn to play it together. Play nice. Play fair.
All right.
Quinn.
Let's see. I think the number one highlight, first of all, was the new coffee machine that we have in the lobby.
Oh.
We have Keurig, as well as Ultimate Micro, has provided various coffee facilities as well.
All praise good coffee.
Is the reason I have not yet murdered anyone this year. So that's, you
is
know,
it, Quinn?
Improvement.
Well,
improvement over last year.
The body count's way down. So I feel like that's...
It's as close to zero as matters.
Yes, exactly.
Was that chair always empty?
You don't remember who was sitting there?
Quinn.
In the middle of my spiel? Dude.
Nothing is an edit point.
Step off. All right. So coffee machine, big highlight for me. Second highlight was beating Carrington three times in a row in the Lode Runner board game, which we talked about on Open Apple, and I was very jealous for not having won the auction for that. I missed it by a day or two, and it turns out the cast of RCR went in on that together, purchased it, and has donated it to Kansas Fest. So come to Kansas Fest, and you too can play the incredibly terrible Lode Runner board game, available only in Japan, and also it's terrible. That's my K-Fest in a nutshell so far.
You know, I can't pick
Jeff
one. I can't pick just one. It's my first time here, so there's a lot of stuff that affected me. I can talk about the camaraderie. I've been with groups of Commodore people, you know, Carrington, same booth is. But
you've been remarkably restrained, by
yeah,
the way.
It's,
you know,
it's in the Boo Atari realm.
The stick is starting to run its course.
Yes.
It's just an amazing group.
It's the coffee.
That's what it is. You know, amazing group of people. I just can't believe the camaraderie and all the fun and everybody has. And yeah, one other thing. This is the first time I actually programmed an assembler on an Apple, thanks to Charles, who's next. I never thought I'd be doing that. And there I was, spending two or three days hacking away at his hardware project, trying to figure out how to...
High five.
Retrocompute!
Nerds!
So how we Boy, that was an Atari-like high five.
Wow.
Oh,
nice.
Wow. Now it began.
Ouch. So I got to play with the assembler, and I used Big Mac, is what I'm using, and it's really nice to work with. I like it. I like the hardware. Over to Charles.
Thanks. I think my biggest accomplishment was getting a Commodore user to program an assembly on an Apple computer. I'm retiring from... The two things that really keep me coming back to Kansas Fest, one is the food here at Rockhurst, and showers. All kidding aside, I thought the session that was kind of a sleeper, I didn't know what to expect from it, from Percolate, the new online service / collaborative emulator for 6502, somewhat based on, but not infringing upon, and yet still backward compatible with AppleSoft, Integer Basic, and disk images for the Apple II. It's the visuals alone were worth checking out the video if you haven't already. The high res low res graphics, but they can do it high res and double high res in three dimensions, doing logo in three dimensions, and all of it's driven by OpenGL. And it just I was talking with them at lunch, and I thought, this sounds like a great idea. It sounds like it's going to be a really good educational resource. But then their presentation, again, they were just very calmly talking about these things, and my mind was just and I'm making the exploding head visual here from scanners. Sorry?
Good radio.
Thank you. Well, mine is the video podcast amongst that just come out of nowhere. And the idea that not only is it such a high technical achievement, but that their goal is to make it an educational resource for kids in the same way that most of us probably were doing things in Logo when we were in the 80s, in whatever school we were in at that time. And that was the highlight to me.
That was one of those sessions that it was hard to wrap your head around everything that it was. Like, they were glossing over a lot of details, but I mean, when they started getting into the shared memory environment across the network, where multiple AppleSoft programs are sharing memory and passing paddle inputs transparently, so that two players are playing Breakout on different machines.
Like a Beowulf cluster.
It's hard to wrap your head around everything.
Imagine Google Docs, but with AppleWorks.
Yeah, it was like, yeah.
You can have two people typing, basically. I don't know how they would share the cursor, but the fact that they could both play Adventure, a text adventure game collaboratively. What do we do now? Go north. Okay. It's like that Parsley adventure that we play sort of collaboratively. just the idea of doing a text adventure collaboratively like that is something that has always been something I've wanted to do.
Well, all of that was basically transparent to the code. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, they downloaded Apple II binaries from Asimov and manipulated them a little bit and then loaded them into this environment, and they ran collaboratively over the network with shared memory between different instances without the applications being aware. It is amazing, really. An AppleSoft basic programs running collaboratively, Google Docs style, you know, with no changes to the code themselves. Yeah, amazing.
So I have to say there were probably two that stood out to me. I would say that Mark's cracking session was incredible, just absolutely incredible. And Quinn's ROM hacking was also fascinating to me. So I was actually really, like, looking at the schedule, I was looking forward to that one. And of course, that's when I get a call from my office with a down situation with a network environment, and I had to step out. But I saw half of it, and it was great.
Should be on video.
Well, I'm only disappointed that they either you didn't ask for or the schedule didn't allow for more time to talk about that, because there I know there was a lot more detail to go into.
Yeah, I think I only asked for a half hour. I should have asked for an hour.
There were so many other sessions that were are just incredible. So anyway, cool. John.
Thank you, Todd.
I was going to actually the same thing in between your Mark's and yours. The mystery, it's like a whodunit almost. So you're delving into this. First of all, your project was to basically decompile the 2C+ ROM, make changes to it because it annoyed you. So, and it's probably annoyed people since the 2C+ came out. And you said, I can do something about that. And then you had to delve into, you know, making your own ROM reader, all the bits and pieces you had to do to make this project or a product, and like you said, the whodunit part of it must have just been really satisfying as you uncovered the clues. So I love that sort of stuff. So those are my favorite sessions.
Next, I'm going to disassemble Carrington because he annoys me to no end.
Count the rings.
He's not programmed in assembler.
Michael.
He's programmed in Lisp.
Know that I definitely like learned a whole lot about how like the Apple II ROM works. I mean, it didn't. I come from a 2+ world where there's a simple. There's no bank switching, and like the idea of all of this stuff is
wormhole entries and venturing off into alternate quadrants just so that it can fix the beep.
Yeah. All right, Michael Mulhern.
Well, again, it came down to great keynote speakers. Kansas Fest is always getting great keynote speakers. And for me, as a Nibble fanboy from way back, to have Mike Harvey here was just tremendous. I used to buy Nibble magazines, every other computer magazine, buy whatever. I'd go down to the municipal library and read the copy in there, but Nibble I would buy, because it just resonated with what I wanted to do programming-wise, It really just cut straight to what was important, technical aspects and great programs and typing in your own listings. And I loved typing in those listings, and I even enjoyed typing in those assembler dumps so that I could have the machine routines and everything. And it was just great to see another outstanding keynote speaker here at KFest.
Yeah. And there were plenty of Nibble magazines for the grab in the garage giveaway.
Mm-hmm. Which I all had anyway, but and coffee. I'm so glad there was real coffee here this year. The warm brown muck that we had to drink previously, distant memory.
Muck is probably giving it a couple points of credit.
Now I'm just a kind of guy, so if it's muck, it's muck.
Now, Rockhurst Dining does their best to accommodate us, but the coffee you're referring to was supplied by fellow Kansas Fest attendees, and there seems to have been multiple outlets at which
I ensured that the multiple outlets all got my custom. So there
was definitely a groundswell in coffee.
Yes. So, from the Keurig machine in the foyer to Ultimate Micro and their unlimited coffee, yes. It was just great.
A bottomless cup, eh?
Bottomless cup, yep.
Well, that's just inefficient.
Is it?
I mean, I don't drink coffee, but I would love the whole point of a cup is to hold a liquid. You people, my goodness.
Super long straw. Are you done? On the subject of Nibble, we should also mention that KFest's own Stavros won an award this year for, among many other accomplishments, having typed in every Nibble program ever published.
Which is now available to download from the Nibble magazine website. Now
for free, I believe.
For free, yeah. Yep.
So,
sometimes it's good to have compulsive behavior on your side.
Eases its powers for good, and we're all grateful for that.
Very good. And Rob McMullen.
Yeah, you mentioned it earlier, Ken, the garage giveaway this year was immense.
3 tons.
Yeah, it was a huge amount of stuff. There was a stack of disk drives probably 4 feet high and 6 feet long.
Did anybody get the final count? There were easily 60. Yeah. I mean, if not more.
Yeah.
Not to mention a nice large stack of Macs.
Yes. Sorry, what? Mac stack?
Stack of Macs.
What?
Stack of Macs.
Mac stack.
Okay.
Mac-henge.
Yeah. Mac-henge, yes, yes.
Those Some things. Of them were fat Macs in the Mac stack.
Yeah, the Fat Macs and the Mac Stack were,
Fat Macs.
There were some color classics in that Mac Stack.
I'm taken aback by the fact that there were that many Macs in the Mac Stack of Fat Macs.
Oh, God.
This is Dr. Seuss.
There's another little Shaq. Oh, Shaq and Mac Clack.
Yeah. Anyway.
They seem to have stole your fire around.
That's right. Well, it was such an immense giveaway that I actually came away with something. I'm not a collector at all. Yeah, I had a chance to get a couple books, and I'm just appreciative of the generosity of this community.
I was trying to explain, someone on Twitter in some thread that I was involved with said, like, there was a pile of free stuff, and I explained to them, it wasn't a pile of free stuff. It was a room of free stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they were just like, I'm making the head explosion thing from scanners.
Good audio. Yeah.
Good radio. Yeah, people with the gestures.
There were supplemental supplies of additional free stuff.
Yeah,
well.
And then more stuff showed up.
Reinforcements of stuff.
Yes. Did somebody show up today with just a handful of Amigas or something?
I'd like to point out means Commodore now has a foothold. In Kansas.
Oh, we've been,
which is why we haven't been bad-mouthing.
You guys going to build a wall?
Oh, I've been bad-mouthing
next time.
They continue to do so.
There's an Amiga with a video toaster in it.
So who was this person?
I have...
Just a local who showed up?
I don't know, actually.
Are they all gone? I don't know.
The story as I heard it, basically, someone who was here...
His name is...
Well, it's conceivable that we don't necessarily need to reveal his name. So someone here... found out that there was nearby an Amiga 3000 to pick up, and went out there to pick it up because it wasn't far.
I think it was someone who was a friend of Becky's, right? Burger Becky's, Bacon.
Yeah. I know who it is. But
okay.
Thank you, to Smith of Kansas City, Missouri, 1414 Main Street.
He says he has a number of valuable classic computers in his basement.
And he's here at the moment, so
right. So it turns out, you know, she went over there, and apparently there's a bunch of there's like a stack of six of these things, and you know, the guy was trying to get rid of them, and so she talked him into bringing them over here, and they showed up. I got a little bit of advance notice, you know, that they were going to show.
Oh, very
did
nice.
You get one?
I did not, because. But yes,
because,
yeah,
because it's better that way.
It's better for other people to have these. Come to the next Kansas Fest and bring a large suitcase.
Yeah, there were a lot of actually posts in the Facebook group this time around, in particular, and Twitter about people asking attendees to bring them stuff or get stuff for them, and. You gotta come. You want stuff from the garage.
You want cables. You got plenty of cables. We can get you those.
Kevin Savitz.
Hello.
Hi.
I enjoyed all the talks, but while those talks were going on, I was sitting in the back listening to them and working on my Hackfest entry, which is usually my favorite thing about Kansas Fest. Just the ability to sit and try something new and really not feel guilty about devoting my time to programming something. I've done two. One of them was just like the fallback in case nothing else happened. Was I made a Twitter bot that posts Apple II crack screens periodically.
So that's you.
That's me. It was a bunch of them on archive.org, like 700. I downloaded them, and now a server just kind of tweets them out every once in a while. I believe the Twitter name is Apple II screens. So that was my first one. And then I sat down and for the first time ever, I wrote a game in 6502 assembly language.
Ooh, nice.
I mean, it's a complete, like, playable, actual thing. And I've never really written a program, a complete program in assembly language, and I did it. And I'm just like, just astounded with myself, frankly.
Can you share some of your, how you got there?
I got there with, where's the book? With that, the assembly
lines. Oh, the assembly lines book.
Yeah, assembly lines, the complete book.
That's why you were carrying that.
By Roger Wagner. I mean, I read it before, and thank you. I read it before. It's by Roger Wagner, edited by Chris Torrance, and it's a really good book, and it taught me everything I needed to know. Oh, well, not everything, because the game works and completely playable, and it's, I think, pretty fun. And it's keeping score, but I don't know how to take that score and actually like put it on the screen. So you have a score, but it doesn't tell you what it is. But anyway.
Send the score to the tweet bot.
Right, send the score, yeah, exactly. Anyway, I was having fun with the Hackfest.
So I think that brings us back to you, Ken.
Back to me. By the way, your Twitter is Apple2Cracks.
Apple2Cracks.
Apple II Cracks.
Yes. And I also did one for Atari screenshots because I had to.
It has no followers.
It has more followers than the Apple One, Carrington.
Kevin, if you'd like to
display Atari 800 screens, I believe.
Atari 800 screens. That sounds. There you go. Yep. It has 24 followers compared to 17 followers.
Instant fact checking.
We could probably fix that.
All right,
Apple2Cracks. That's Apple II.
I think Charles has a way that you may be able to display your score. Maybe in colors.
Perhaps in color. I was thinking on a 7-segment display using the I/O board that I brought with me.
And
if you do that, then you could enter both the Hackfest and the Mini Hackfest.
Great.
And you could take home a little I/O board that I made.
So we're supposed to follow the Atari 800 screens, right?
Yes, Atari 800 screens.
Got 18 hours left.
All right. So thank you, Kevin. My favorite thing, or my most interesting thing about Kansas Fest, has been all the Pokemans I've caught. No, I'm kidding. I've really enjoyed all the games that have been at Kansas Fest this year. I'm a big game enthusiast. That's what my two main podcasts are about. And the games have just permeated this event. I put games in Juicy Jess all the time. I have done 22 color covers. 5 of them have been games. That's a significant portion. That represents the editor's interest. And Kansas Fest has filled that need quite neatly. Kate, a first-time attendee this year, brought her MAME cabinet, or MAME console. It's a Mac Mini, and she has this... Carrington, what do you call it? Just a joystick?
I call it a joystick.
It's much, much bigger.
It's like an X-Arcade.
Yeah,
stick. Thank you, yes. Joystick. It's an X-Arcade, so it has 2 joysticks, 6 buttons per joystick, and a trackball, and one and a spinner.
She added the spinner,
A spinner?
Yeah, mm-hmm. There's a spinner for Arcanine.
Right. Wow, I didn't even notice that. That's amazing.
Breakout.
Tron.
It's a silver knob.
Yeah. So, whatever. So whatever ROM you load, you have a way to play it that is arcade authentic, which I was a huge fan of. She just set this up in the lobby for anybody to play, and it was great.
Sean Fahey is way better than Carrington and Galaga.
That has been established on multiple machines now.
Well, especially since the Galaga coin-op that's in Massman Hall here at Rockhurst, it's
out of order, yeah.
No. They put up that sign to deter all the soccer camp kids. The game actually works, and they gave us permission to plug it in. But the joystick is wonky, you can't. It doesn't respond very well.
The Golden Tee's broken.
You know it's not going to be fixed unless Play Plus does it next year.
That's very likely.
You can enter that as your Nano Hackfest, which goes inside your micro. I don't know how this works.
I do part-time arcade repairs. So
yeah, why don't we go over there?
You can take a look,
and I can pick a lock. Yeah.
You still got another 36 hours.
Cool.
So. Hackfest entry. I fixed the
count. And I'm not nearly as sleep deprived as I thought I'd be.
There you go. So it'll hit you. Don't worry.
Especially you, vinyl over springs as a mattress.
But I also
I changed my favorite thing.
So we actually had to break away from some games to record this podcast because just an hour ago there were 3 different games going on in the main presentation hall. As Quinn mentioned, there was Load Runner, the board game. Some people didn't even know that they're
Carrington.
Is it fun?
Is it trend?
No. Yeah. No, it's terrible.
Oh.
Fun?
But I'm much better at it than Carrington. So there's that. That was pretty fun for me.
I wouldn't say it's terrible. It's definitely unplayable by anybody who isn't already a fan of Load Runner.
Okay.
You kind of have to come to it with Load Runner knowledge.
Sure.
But if you're 4 retro computing fans,
That might be why it was never released outside Japan.
Yeah, like, yeah, it's not awful, but we got some house rules that improve it a bit.
Cool.
It's good.
And I mean, I should distinguish, we had fun playing it, which is different than it being a good game.
Yes, that's it, exactly.
Carcassonne or Settlers of Catan, it is not. But it is very emblematic of those 80s board game, video game conversions.
Gotcha.
And the charm factor is
unbeatable. Yeah, I think we can turn into a bit of a drinking game, catching the gold.
Yeah. Yeah. If we had any beer left.
Honestly.
I'm sorry. I had no idea 20 Kevin Savitzes would show up.
It's the kind of game, though, you'd only ever play at Kansas Fest. Like, right. I have no one else in my life that would sit down and spend a couple hours playing the Lode Runner board game. And here, easily we're going to have more people.
In all honesty, that is why I listed it as a highlight, because that was a fun, probably once or twice in a lifetime experience, because who else is going to own that and play it with
me? Which is why the game is now owned by Kansas Fest. It's been donated by RCR and will appear here every year, so you can get better at it, Quinn.
Yes. And if that's not a reason to come here.
Right, I know.
The Lode Runner board game strategy guide.
Oh yeah.
You could write a bot that plays it for you.
Well, no, I'm already working on the Lode Runner board game, the video game.
There you go. Next year's Hackfest.
Yeah.
Kevin helped me film an unboxing video for the board game that'll be going up on my YouTube channel.
Well, I might have lost. I would still say I'm probably top 4 Lode Runner board game player in the world.
So how many people played? 4?
4.
Yeah.
And I was definitely one of them.
Okay. This is likely the only copy in the world of this game.
And that wasn't the only 4-player game in that room. We were also playing Kaboom by Ninja Force. We were using the 4-play card, which just recently made its debut, allowing 4 joysticks to be inputted into the Apple II simultaneously.
That is a masterful segue. Thank you very much.
You're welcome, and thank you for making it more natural. We were also using
that was a good segue.
Wasn't it?
We should call it out some more.
Dean came in. Really?
I've never gotten to ride a segue.
Oh, Dean came in would be proud. So,
speaking of which.
And and we were using a VGA adapter, too. So the game looked gorgeous on that projector. And right next door to that was an iOS tournament for the game Structurus, which we have played in tournament form here on the Apple II before. But now it has been ported to iOS. The game is originally by Martin Hay, and the port is by Call Apple, featuring starring Bill Martins and Brian Weiser on the development side, as well as some other individuals. So it was great to have 3 different games going on at the same time. 2 of them competitive. There are prizes at the end. And the third one, the board game, just being, why the heck not?
And how did you do on Kaboom, Ken?
I think I lost to a rather hirsute individual. I hardly
mean Charles Mountain
him.
Man Mengen?
That would be it. One half of the Beagle Brothers cosplay. That'll be coming next year. However, that was only the first round. I don't know how that works. If the top 2 of each round go to the next round, if the top 1, you may get blown to bits in the next round.
Or I may be getting bypassed right now because it may be going on while we're recording.
So as you can hear, there have been a ton of amazing things happening at KFest this year, which is all the more reason why you should come next year, July 18th to the 23rd, 2017, KansasFest.org for more details. But in the meantime, I thought now that we've all gotten to know Kansas Fest, we should get to know each other.
Okay. All right, turn the lights down.
So we have a game we're going to play. No, John, we're not playing Special Places.
I'm going to need more beer.
Yeah. We're going to play a game called Whodunit. And to introduce the game, here's Kevin Savitz.
So. More beer.
Hi, I'm Kevin Savitz.
Hi, Kevin.
Hi.
Hi, Kevin.
So we're going to, before we started the show, we all wrote down a thing on an index card. Thing about ourselves. And something that's maybe about retro computing and hopefully unique. So I'm right now shuffling these cards, and I'm going to pass the cards out to everybody. And everyone's going to read their card, and we're going to go around the circle. It's their job to read the card, read it out loud, and guess who wrote the card. For instance, I might have written down, I once shot a man in Reno just to watch him die.
We all knew that.
Quinn.
I'm guessing Quinn. Am I right?
Last year.
Right. Quinn might get the card, and then clearly think it was Ken, and then she would be wrong. So that's that. So I'm going to pass these cards out. I'm passing out the cards, and Ken, I give it back to you to steer the ship.
Oh dear. So that means you want me to go first?
Sure.
Great. Okay, so I will read my card, and then I'll guess whose card it is.
Yeah, and you want to talk about your logic or whatever?
Or lack thereof.
Or lack thereof, yeah.
So my card says, I once rode to Kansas Fest 2 days across country with someone I had just met. Well, if this was some sort of a rom-com, I would think it was some sort of a date movie or somebody, like, you just picked up a somebody. But no, I mean, carpools for Kansas Fest are pretty common. People coordinate, collaborate online. So I don't know that this is as dramatic as I hoped it would be. Certainly nobody died in Reno, unfortunately. But I know it's not me. I know it's not Kevin, because he flies from Portland. I know it's not Michael, because he flies from Australia. I know it's not Todd or Jeff, because you've never been to Kansas Fest before. Although, this could be today. So I once rode to Kansas Fest. You could still only come to Kansas Fest once, and it could be true. I don't think it's Quinn, because I don't think you've ever driven here. Although it kind of would be across country, because you're coming from California. Paul, you fly from Boston. So I'm narrowing it down to John, Rob, Charles, or Carrington. So I've narrowed it down to 4 out of 11, or 4 out of 10, because I knew it wasn't
the most. No fair using logic.
Am I being too verbose about this? I'm sorry.
It's supposed to be an hour podcast.
Yeah, but to heck with that. Okay, Carrington usually comes on a Vespa. That's Ooh. Not going to be very accommodating for a second person. Once. It's often enough. Anyway.
But if it's released on the open app.
Once a Vespa.
Always a Vespa. I did see a photo of you in the car with Michael Mulhern, but then you went your own ways, as far as I know. So you didn't arrive together. I don't think Charles is carpooled. So now I'm narrowed down to Rob or John. And I don't think John carpooled. So I'm going to say Rob. Is it yours?
I fly. Myself.
So now what? Do I do a second choice? Wait, you fly... Did you say you fly by yourself? You fly yourself?
I fly. But somebody else flies the plane.
Because
they don't even ask for help.
Because there have been people who have flown themselves to Kansas Fest. They have their own plane.
But. Do you want to make a second guess, or do you just want the person to admit?
He guessed Rob, so now Rob gets a chance to play. Whoever gets there is right first wins, and then the second.
There's new rules.
Do we not find out who this is?
No, yeah, because if you reveal them all, the last person will be.
We'll find yours out later.
Okay.
But now Rob gets to play.
Yeah.
Because otherwise the last person would know who's
Now you read your card.
Alright, so we'll be
okay. I used a K-Pro to connect to a router serial interface at work. So we need somebody who works in IT. We're all old enough to know what a K-Pro is.
What?
It's retro.
Ken just took himself out. Michael works in IT. Oh, you got a call, so you...
good reference. You're listening.
Although I have to say Michael.
No.
Mm-hmm. All right. So that's Michael's
turn. The day I met her, I offended Quinn with the question, what kind of name is Dunkey?
Carrington. I wish. No, but man, that's a lost opportunity.
So,
I mean, it was me up until with the question. Period. Sure, but that's all of us, right?
Still.
Yeah. No, not me.
No, well, when it just came to offending Quinn, I just couldn't think of anyone else.
I was so close. Nope. Okay,
well,
I got
winning in that aspect.
My card says, I recycled a sun monitor. Frowny face. There's an emoticon on my card. Weirdly, I'm going to guess Paul. Even though, as far as I know, Paul has everything. So that's why I think you might actually regret having once let something go.
We are. You know he doesn't recycle.
So far, yes. We don't know each
awesome.
Other at all.
At all. I don't know you people.
Who are you?
I had to defend my use of using a picture I had drawn on my 2E to my art teacher, who was not convinced it was a viable medium.
Gotcha.
So 2E, I think, is going to be mainly what I have to work with here.
Type.
Kevin.
No.
Kevin, sir.
This one, I'm going to read it verbatim. It says, run win 1.0 in a VM. run win 1.0 in a VM. So the person whose card I'm reading is not literate. Carrington. No.
I think I can parse that sentence.
I'm going to assume I run Windows 1.0 in a virtual machine. It could be any of us geeks, frankly. Any of us.
I'm going to guess the Internet Archive.
It's on a website. Nice.
I feel like I know the answer to that one, but
what, having written the card?
No.
I remember well.
Are we allowed to help other people?
Sure, yes. I would appreciate.
Yeah, let's get some right answers.
No one has been right.
You should define that rule.
At this point, I would just be guessing. So tell me.
My guess would be someone who has a collection of old MS-DOS and Windows versions and has not been able to find Windows 1.0 or has recently found Windows 1.0 and was able to then get it to run in a VM. Mm. And I think that was either discussed or either in a podcast or some medium similar to that. But I'm not going to tell you who it is.
Just using your lifelines.
Except that I'm going to tell you it probably wasn't me. Probably. I'll give you that hint.
All right.
It's like
something
my son would do.
Well, yeah, now this is like homework. Who did the reading?
Jeff Salzman did it in the library.
With
the
candlestick. Candlestick. No, I did not.
I believe...
John.
Yep.
All right. John.
All right. I asked the head of the computer science department if I could get academic credit for completing programming lessons from the ByteWorks. He said no, so I switched majors.
Stuck it to the man.
All right. I could say the easy answer and just pick Carrington again.
Have a rep.
Paul.
No.
All right.
But now we have a problem.
Oh, that's right, because I've already picked.
Well, then it should go in a certain direction to the next person who hasn't been picked yet.
Or he just picks someone.
Yeah. Oh, I get to. Oh, do I? Maybe I get.
Maybe you get to guess again.
Yeah,
on yours.
That's the thing. You guess again.
Oh, yeah.
I like it.
That's the point, people.
Oh, okay. So I try to guess the one that's.
So yours was the art teacher.
All right, here we go. I had to defend my use of using a picture I had drawn on my 2E to my art teacher, who was not convinced it was a viable medium. I have to pick someone other than Kevin.
Wait, so anybody know anybody else here who draws? Like, who's a great drawing person?
Maybe it's Hitler.
Yeah, I would have thought it's you.
Yeah.
Did you say
I'll say John. I'll say John.
He wanted to be an artist.
Just, I'm handing it right back to John.
Yes.
Okay. Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Now, was that because you... You didn't want to do the work in a traditional medium, or
no,
just because you wanted to work in an Apple II?
It was art class, and I thought it would be interesting to do so. So I did a little paint program, because we didn't have any, so it was just a little, you know, space bar to turn the cursor on, space bar to turn the cursor off. Did something, it was actually the Apple logo on my Apple IIe in high school, and printed it out on my image writer, and they said, no, the computer did this. And I'm like, no, the computer didn't do that. So, there you go.
Actually, you should have handed in a printout of Snoopy going, curse you, Red Baron, on green paper. That the computer did.
I actually had a teacher who declined my homework assignment because I had typed it in a computer and printed it out on the printer. She said I was unable to do that. I had to take it back and handwrite it.
Wow. I had that happen when I was in third grade.
Yep.
They said it was an unfair advantage because only 3 out of 20 students had a computer.
Here we go, self-deprecating. How could it be unfair? I did it on a Commodore, which was obviously,
exactly.
Yeah,
it's
right?
Really more of a handicap.
Exactly. Thank you.
All right. So
he took me as guest.
So Paul wins. So
does that mean I go back to me and pick somebody else?
What was your question?
All right. I asked the head of the computer science department if I could get academic credit for completing programming lessons from the ByteWorks. He said no, so I switched majors. You.
It would have helped if I finished university.
Ah, okay.
Well, it doesn't say that person finished.
But still no.
Okay.
All right, Michael,
your turn. Okay. So it wasn't Carrington that when meeting Quinn offended her with the name, what kind of name is Dunkey?
That's not how I offended her.
No.
It was me.
You looked at your mom and
I looked at my mom and said, what the hell?
Well, you were my second choice.
I'm a lot of people's second choice.
Are you, Quinn? Are you?
Yeah. In the
fields. Very nice.
Those listening were laughing
and doing the scanner's head
exploding. Yeah.
Literally.
Figure.
Receive, Michael.
What were we doing?
What kind of name is Duncan?
So you're thinking I offended Quinn in the manner suggested?
Yes.
I did not.
I thought you might have had pity on you.
I'm still surprised it's not me.
It's not too late. So
you're offensive before you open your mouth.
This is true. Yes, before this.
Okay. Now they're both offensive.
I once rode to Kansas for 2 reasons. Days across country with someone I had just met, Charles.
That was me.
Yeah. Nice.
Nice. We have two winners. Ben.
Who did you?
So who did? Yeah. Who did you meet?
I had
Charles Manson.
No, but funny story. I met Mark Pilgrim literally the day before we were going to get in a car and drive across country, stay the night in Nashville, and then continue on to Kansas Fest. And the first question that we each asked of the other was, do you smoke? The second one was, do you listen to talk radio? And then the third, and this was mostly prompted by our respective wives, are you a serial killer?
That was third.
Yeah. each of our answers matched, and that's fine. So we were then able to proceed into who...
It was no, and yes.
Whose car we were going to... I'm going to leave that to your imagination. But whose car we were going to ride in, and how to split up gas and driving and that kind of stuff. And... since then, that was this is our third year of carpooling doing the same trip, and we still haven't killed one another or abandoned one another on the side of the road, and I think that's a successful
or picked up smoking.
Yeah, and that's a successful
or stopped
friendship kicked off by Kansas Fest and our collective love of traveling cross country to mess with old computers for a week.
It's funny, I get the same question from my wife every time I do a Craigslist deal. Is the dude a serial killer? I'm like, I don't know yet.
Does the listing say serial killer?
It said nothing about that.
You have to look at the abbreviations.
A checkbox,
right? They use the little abbreviations SC sometimes. Or
it also depends on what
SK.
Section.
SK.
What section of Craigslist?
You're the illiterate one.
So now Charles gets the S.
Back in the day, I sent in a program to a computer magazine that I had typed in on a typewriter. So who is who uses the phrase back in the day? Aside from me, because it comes flowing out. A program on a computer to a computer magazine I typed in on a typewriter. So old enough to not only know how to use a typewriter, but probably needed to use it because he didn't have a printer or whatever medium to maybe write longhand. I don't know. Could you write a program in longhand and send it to a computer magazine?
Old enough to have read a magazine.
Old enough, but still old enough to have read a magazine. Well, there are. Well, 321 Contact wouldn't be counted as a computer magazine. I read that when I was really little. I mean, before I got into hardcore computing.
Is that what we do, hardcore
computing? Well, it was a hardcore computist.
Hardcore something.
Yeah. Computist. I'm just gonna
find that term.
I'm just gonna throw a guess to the wind and say, because I don't know enough about the typewriting habits of anyone in the room, I'm gonna say Kevin.
No, not me. But ever since you said 321 Contact, I have the Bloodhound Gang song going through my head.
You're welcome.
And just like that, it's Girl from Ipanema.
Don't worry, we're never gonna give you up.
All right, back to me. Damn it. Playing all three of them are just playing around.
I can't concentrate. Take you down.
Run Win 1.0 into the app. Can you help me out and let me know who's left, who hasn't been?
So it's not John or Charles.
Right. But other people have submitted to things.
Only two winners since it's two we know who.
Well, who else did you guess that it wasn't?
It's John.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's not John.
Okay.
Yeah. We knew it wasn't John.
Right. Because we know what John is. Right.
Jeff?
No.
Not Jeff. All right.
My son, maybe, but not me.
You helped him.
I didn't write that down. Wait.
In the living room, yes.
I implemented a bug fix suggested by Burger Becky. Now I'm at a disadvantage here. Who's Burger Becky?
She's Rebecca Heinemann. She is here at Kansas Fest. She programmed a lot of things for the Apple II, which I cannot list any of them.
A lot.
And she's
Zany Golf, Out of This World.
She was the keynote last year, right?
She's an attendee this year.
Yeah.
Also, sweet open Apple interview. Very highly recommended.
This has to be Queen.
And she did a lovely interview for Antic.
I haven't gotten there yet.
Ah,
I apologize.
That's the one that I handed back because I already knew that.
It was
the handwriting also kind of gave it away.
It was the 2C message.
Circle was a little hard over the eyes.
I think it was me.
Why did I put unicorns in the margins? You're all sexist, by the way.
Hey, I said nothing.
What's wrong with the unicorn?
But you laughed,
that's
and that's
saying.
Still bad.
You haven't seen my card. I may have unicorns in the margin. Just saying.
Fair enough. So I guess that means I go next. Last year at KFest, I had a bug in my mouse driver that I could not fix. I described it in my session, and after my session on that driver, Rebecca suggested a fix, which I had implemented.
That was the 2C mouse driver, wasn't it?
Yep. Yeah. And then in my follow-up session about something else, I was able to present the fixed driver. So that was a best classic moment for me.
If I might just interrupt to mention that kind of thing is happening also this year, because at least some, I think it was Dagan's session, who he was demoing Rastan as part of the thing. The guy who wrote Rastan is in the audience. It's amazing.
Wow.
It's an amazing place to be.
That's the only thing. Only place that's going to happen is KFest. We were talking about this, that Rastan was a game that melted my brain when I was young, and then I had lunch today with the guy that wrote it.
And I bet he'll be back next year, July 17th, 2017, for the 29th annual.
I just got to set out $20 a week for the next 50 weeks to come back here.
All right, so mine is, I wrote an ELIZA program to auto-chat with people who called up to transfer files, presumably on a BBS, by patching the transfer program. This feels like a Kevin Savitz joint to me.
It's not.
Back to you.
Oh,
sir.
Back to me. Run Windows 1.0 in a day. I feel like I really know the projects that Rob is up to. He has better use of his time in diddling about with Windows. Michael. Seems like a really good use of your time.
Ah!
You, Michael
Bird. Yes.
Yes.
And I deliberately wrote it to make it difficult to parse.
And have succeeded.
And it's also in present tense. Not you once ran it in a VM.
The VM might be running it.
Run
at
it
his,
right
his
right
house
now.
Right now, or on his laptop somewhere.
Well, forever is my nail.
So why have or did you do this? Why would you subject yourself to this?
Why? Well, since when did I need a why?
It's the wrong conference for why.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right.
Michael, your turn.
Okay. The day I met her, I offended Queen with the question of what kind of name is Dunkey? The difficult part is, the first thing that went through my mind is which dead bodies are lying around the place, but a dead person couldn't actually write this. So...
Sure, it's not Carrington.
Never can tell.
Just keep picking him. Eventually, we'll wear him down.
Well, this time, I think I'll go for the person that I most think that wouldn't do it. So I say Paul.
Nope.
Wow, I see. I would have been my guess, too.
It's okay.
Charles.
Oh, back in the day, I sent in a program to a computer magazine that I typed in on a typewriter. And just to make things difficult, I'm going to say Paul.
No.
Okay. So that brings it back to me again. Back in the day, I sent in a program to a computer magazine that I typed in on a typewriter. Okay, so I'm going to take Ken's approach here and apply logic.
Ooh.
We know it's not
science.
I love that that's you now unique to me.
it's a new approach for me. I don't think I've ever. I know that it's not Kevin because I guessed you before. Typed on a typewriter.
It does sound like something I would do. I might have actually done that at some point, but
recently.
You
still might.
He's doing it right now.
I'm going to go with either Jeff or Carrington, and rather than... I'm just going to guess Jeff, because he's talking about how old he is all the time.
I still have typewriters, but I didn't write any... Actually, I did write code on a typewriter, but not anything I turned into a magazine.
Do you recall writing this card?
what
day is it?
Is it typewritten?
All right, so then it carries to me. I wrote an ELIZA program to auto-chat with people who called up to transfer files by patching the transfer program. It spelled Twitter body to me, which is why I guess Mr. Savitz. So, So, let's see. So, who can I not guess now again? Who's out? Who have we determined?
I am out.
And Michael is in.
All right. Okay. Okay.
I'm confused about this game.
Wait, how did it go from Jeff to Quinn?
Because I already guessed.
He guessed. Yeah,
my card isn't.
Jeff
we're just
going
to move.
And which one is it?
I guess someone wins the card.
Yeah, it would be Jeff's turn, but he's already won.
I already
so
I took third place.
Just carries to me.
Oh,
just
I
everybody else gets a participation.
Oh, I missed that happening.
It's another house rule. Just let it go.
This makes perfect sense, people. I don't know why I'm struggling with this. All right. This is sort of. Eliza is sort of linguistic-y, so I'm going to say Paul.
That is correct.
All right.
Hey! Fourth place.
That's actually a brilliant idea.
It was pretty cool. It was a chat program, you know, specifically for the AppleCat that it had a chat window. You know, it would sort of transfer, but every once in a while it would pause, and you could chat back and forth. But you know, if you're just running a BBS or whatever, there's nothing going on. So I figured it was sort of like a little game that people play. So.
All right. Fun.
Who goes next?
So you won. So
yeah.
Right. So it carries to Kevin now.
Oh, we're going.
No,
I have figured mine out.
Has
the Windows thing.
Did Karen figure out his?
Yep.
No, but it would be Paul's turn.
Oh, we're
so
going.
He's
sorry.
Out. So you carry
oh,
on
I
from whose turn it would have been.
So maybe it's Rob now.
So
only
yeah,
you understand this game.
I still
yeah.
Apparently, you haven't gone yet, Rob.
He did one.
He just
had
to say
again. It's
the
logic that she's applying.
So I used a Cape Road to connect to a router serial interface at work. And so wait, who's out?
So yeah, show of hands if you are out.
How about show of hands if you're in?
So we have three.
Show of hands if you're in.
Right.
Of your in?
So yeah.
Okay, hands down if you have a cape rope.
Doesn't everybody?
Nope. I'm going to be sending mine right back at you. I recycled the sun monitor, and I think it's you.
I used to unrecycle
it. You're turning
it
back
to
you. Another chance.
All right. Cape rope to connect to a router serial interface at work. Todd?
No.
Did
sorry.
I see already?
No.
Todd's turn.
I do have a cape rope, though. And I have thought about connecting it. Mine is awesome, and it says, I broke up with someone over an operating system choice.
All right, who hasn't?
Yeah, to be honest.
I'm going to go with Ken.
That is something I would do. And no. It's my turn. No, I already got mine. So it goes to the left.
Goes back
to
the
Cape Row. Okay.
If you've won, you're out, just put your card down.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, there you go.
Cape Row, serial interface.
You're supposed to be able to hear the gears turning.
For the TV audience,
just start guessing.
Should we do the who's in still thing?
Yeah, I'm just kidding.
Well, if you're holding a card, you're still in.
Oh,
except that
well,
you can't guess me because
there's two kinds of in.
No, I have not guessed properly yet, so.
So who, okay, raise your hand if I can possibly guess you.
Do that. Possible targets.
No.
No, wasn't me.
Shit. Oh, so it's back to me again.
Yeah.
So it's down to Carrington, and who else was guessing?
Jeff.
Jeff.
He's got a 50-50 chance.
I got. Well, I already guessed Karen, so it's gotta be him.
It's me. All right.
Yeah.
Well, that's a charm.
That's 11 players.
So, what did you do when you
came? Just really bad at this game.
I had recently, being VCF Midwest last year, acquired a cave row, and I brought it into work one morning. I get into work a lot earlier than other people, and there was a nearly decommissioned Cisco router, and they had the little serial cable, so I thought I'd hook up the terminal program and see if I can get to the control screen. It wasn't anything in production, so nothing went down, but it was fun to hook that up.
Capro had there was a magazine called Profiles that was specifically for Capro users, and I just recently came across this really quite hilarious cover for one of them, which is like this woman on roller skates with her Capro, going to work
that.
Or whatever. Yeah. It's really, it was
and another Capro for ballast.
Yeah. I was going to say, there's no way you could roller skate with a Capro. Yeah. No
way. Wheels slowly sinking into the ground from all the weight.
Yeah.
Was the Capro magazine really big with text was small?
That was the Osborne magazine.
That was the Osborne.
Oh, yes.
No, I like it. It was a nearly decommissioned router. So Everyone on the third floor is just like, what's going on? But
it wasn't hooked up to any part of the network. It's just probably.
That mattered.
Yeah. That mattered.
The third floor knows what it did.
So does it go back to Michael then?
Yeah, what kind of name is Dunkey? So what are my choices?
No. I'm just still in.
So I'd still be in.
Kevin.
Yes.
Oh, wait, I should put my hand up. Sorry.
It still wouldn't have changed my mind.
But no, you already guessed
too many.
To be fair, I don't remember this incident, so clearly I wasn't offended.
You have to try harder next time.
It was a couple of years ago when we were in the even jankier than usual cafeteria.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
And I just remember it, and I just wanted to know what part of the world Dunkey came from, I could have ask the question in a more diplomatic manner.
Well, it's all in the inflection.
So do you have
I think I inflected completely poorly. And she gave me an answer after she got over her disoffiness, and I don't even remember what the answer is anymore. So.
It does sound like me, but I don't
remember.
Somebody
else get injured now.
What is the answer?
Swiss.
Gotcha.
All right, so I guess that's back to me then?
I was really confused why you guessed me for something else, because I'm just like, I really thought you would have known.
Yeah, no, I honestly have no memory of this incident, so.
Right. Now you can hold it against me.
There's so much anger.
Yeah, it just blurs together into one white hot.
She's trying to lull you into a false sense of security by saying, oh, no, did not.
Yeah.
All right, so I asked the head of the computer science department if I could get academic credit for completing program lessons from the Mike Works. He said no, so I switched majors. Who's left? You.
No. He said, oh, you.
Je choose.
I broke up with someone over an operating system choice. I love this question so much. I'm going to use the phone a friend. Who is left that I can guess?
Oh, you're guessing.
Carrington.
Yep.
Nice.
The twist is, though, I didn't do the breaking up.
Okay.
That does not surprise me.
Second girlfriend, and I was badgering her about her operating system choice because she was a Windows person, and by that point was Mac. And I said, she was about to buy another computer. I said, don't buy a Windows computer, you're just going to fill it with viruses, like an idiot. I say that kind of stuff. 2 days later, comes to school, this is high school, says, I got a virus on my computer. I just looked at her, she said, we're done. So I didn't have to say anything by expression, and I learned a lesson.
Your look said, I told you so.
What gets me that it had to be an operating system? I thought for you it would have at least been an indenting style in programming.
Oh, sure. Yeah, that would have
That's not funny. That's a great way to do that.
It's documented.
I'm only surprised that being Carrington, he didn't word it. I broke up with a partner over a virus.
That
I need another card.
Much better wording.
Well done.
There was no A or anything in it. So.
I didn't write it with the accent.
Yeah.
Try to throw you.
Distraction.
Okay, so on me. I recycled a Sun monitor. Who's left? We only had two choices I was so sure about. No, I've already guessed you.
No.
And didn't I guess you already too? Okay, that's fine.
It's definitely me.
Oh.
Yeah. And I regret that choice to this day, for the record.
Why?
But I apologize, because I'm a restoration guy. I'm a repair and restoration guy.
Plus, it's Samsung green.
The monitor worked absolutely perfectly, and it was gorgeous. And I got tired of stubbing my toe on it.
How could
you?
I
know, I'm kidding. I'm not kidding. I stubbed my toe on it and moved it to the recycle pile. And
but probably all of us have gotten rid of working things that we now think, oh my goodness, why did I do that? I have tons of hardware that I have to shamefully admit I have recycled back before I got back into the hobby.
I just want to say that I think this is a, you know, this should just let us know how we need to be around him if all he did was stub his toe on something and it went to the curb.
I'm just saying, for like the third or fourth time.
Any of us could be next. Yeah. Any of us.
So I think what we've learned is while we all think that Quinn is the one with the temper,
Todd's
the quiet one. He kicks to the curb.
He recycles to the curb.
All right,
so do we rotate left? Is that right? Okay. So back in the day, I sent in a program to a computer magazine that I typed in on a typewriter, and who is left?
Ken and Rob are left.
Need a quarter.
This seemed like such a Carrington thing. No, I'm done.
A lot of things.
I'm gonna guess Rob.
Yep.
What's the story?
Yeah, we have to know Atari. I had a 1200 XL was my first machine. I only had two joystick ports. And so a magazine came out and said, OLED XL is bad, only has two joystick ports. So I wrote a program that said, you can read joysticks 3 and 4 from ports 1 and 2. Typed it up on a typewriter because I didn't have printer, I had nothing. But sent it back in. And of course, you can't actually play 4 people on a 2-person joystick.
So they didn't run your program?
No. They need to send me a rejection letter.
Ouch.
Apples have one joystick port.
So can a typewriter is like a printer with pressy bits in the front.
Wow.
All right, I think that's me. And I think I have a pretty easy choice at this point.
Can you reread your thing?
Yes, I asked the head of the computer science department if I could get academic credit for completing program lessons from the ByteWorks. He said no, so I switched majors. Sir, is this your card?
It is indeed. So does that mean that I also win because I was the hardest to guess?
No.
It just means that none of us know you very well.
You know, you lose.
Just the way I like it.
The enigma that is Ken.
So I went to college for computer science. That was my major, and chose a very technical school. I wished to major in computer science. They didn't have much in the way of humanities. And I actually did a whole moth story about this, which was that I loved the Apple II. I loved the machine. I loved the creativity and the passion and the community around it, because at that time I was on CompuServe and Genie, and I knew the kind of people who use these machines. And I went to WPI, and they had an advanced placement test you could take to get out of CS 101, and you had to know either C++ or Pascal. I knew neither, it was basic, is what I knew. I took an assembly language class, and they gave us some assembly code, and they said, translate this into a high-level language, and I said, you mean like basic? And all the other students laughed at me because they all knew C++ or Pascal. Mm. And these languages that I was learning, I know that there are equivalents on the Apple II, but learning them on a Mac or a Windows machine just was not fun at all. And nobody in my class was there because they were having fun. They were there because they wanted to make a lot of money, which is what my dad wanted me to do. Or they were there because they thought they were wicked smart and they wanted to be condescending to people who knew basic. And so I went to my head of the department in one last ditch effort to make computer science fun. And I said, can I learn something on my Apple II? And he said, no. I'm like, well, you know what? I'm failing anyway, so might as well switch majors. And that's how I became a writer.
Very good.
You never touched a computer again.
Nope. And here I am editing Juice.js.
I think, yes, and I think the world is a better place for you being a writer than being a condescending computer scientist.
Right. Because we all know how that would have
turned
out.
Sort of a backhanded compliment.
So,
Danny with faint praise.
So that is the end of the game Whodunit. However, it does bring up a very intriguing story that we should revisit Carrington. So you told us about this virus story. We would like to hear more about your dating life.
This podcast has taken an odd turn.
But not an unexpected one, because this is scripted.
Okay, well, I'll give a quick story, and then I'll throw it out to the crowd here, because I'm sure everyone has similar things. So, yes, like all nerds, not that successful. I like big gestures, romantic things, stuff like that. And so, tied into the theme, I've been trying to think, what can I say that ties into Kansas Fest? So this year, my door is a pirate door. I like to have an interactive door. Last year it was a choose your own adventure game. This year it's a scavenger hunt. Starts at my door with a big pirate head on it. And if you open up the little box, you get a code, and it will lead you, if you can crack that code, to 9 other places, 10 locations total, that will eventually lead to a treasure map. And if you can find the treasure map, that will lead you to a buried treasure chest here on the campus someplace. There's at least 2 people, participants, who are up to code number 6 at the moment. So lots of time left for them to win, and others nipping at their heels, so I'm sure the chest will be found. So keeping with the pirate theme, which I picked this year because of all the 4 a.m. stuff, one particularly unsuccessful date that ended in a that's it, was I made a pirate attack. So unfortunately chose it for, I think, a second date, so a little early to go full Carrington. And,
you never go full Carrington.
Never go full Carrington. Not until double digits. So I had, you rent out the restaurant. I learned a date by watching John Hughes movies, right? So you think, you're supposed to have the whole thing. So got friends and other people, dates best if there's a cast. And so the idea was, we would go to a restaurant and there'd be a few people there. And then at one point, they'd come out and ask, how do we like the meal? And I would have a small complaint. There would be a bellow of anger from the kitchen. Out would storm a large, angry pirate chef who would come and threaten us with his little hook hand and say, what, you dare? But, so, well, I then get taken by all the waiters who will pull out their swashbuckling swords. Yes, indeed, second date. And they would threaten me, and I would be in the corner because all week. They would drop both a pirate map and another sword that my date could then pick up. They would immediately cower from her, and we could grab the treasure map and head out on the what would be the actual date. And we're going on a little scavenger hunt that my friends had set up so I wouldn't know where the places were. We would be pursued by pirates, and we would get to know each other. Second date, we would get to know each other, and this was a good way to get to know me. Like, so kind of get. So, I complain, bellowing pirate chef comes out, all the knives of half the restaurant breaks into pirate regalia. I have patches of foot on. I am threatened by the swords. I'm in the corner. They drop the pirate mat at her feet. They drop the sword at her feet right. She's at the desk. And everyone's like, if anybody else would grab this, we'd cower. And everyone's waiting for her. And she just looks at me and says, take me home. Not at all interested. Sometimes these things go really well. If it's not the second date, and someone
that should have been awesome on the first date.
No, this was one of the times where I learned ease into Carrington, right? So, she's not interested, everyone there is like, what do we do? Just uncomfortable silence, and said, well, thanks guys, and took her home, and that was date 2 and final date. So, sometimes it goes well, sometimes it goes poorly.
I was going to ask.
Scavenger Hunt's going better this year.
I was going to ask if that was operating system version, but apparently not. That was last date.
Can you talk about a time where your silliness went well?
Sure.
Has it ever gone well?
Yes, yeah. I mean, I do that kind of thing, so I like alien adventures and scavenger hunts and I teach ballroom dancing, and so my dance partner and I, who were romantically entangled for a while, we would set up dancing dates in interesting places where we would go and try to see who could teach the most people a given dance in a given place. Like, go to a railway station and say, okay, let's 10 people to rumba, let's go. She's got to find 10 guys, I got to find 10 girls, or whomever, and get 10 people who don't know how to rumba to know how to rumba, and we check them off and have a big set of signs, have a competition. That kind of date goes great. So with the right person, these things are awesome. With the wrong person, these things are take me home.
Two things come to my mind. And I'm just going to limit it to the first two.
And then we can open this up to others and we can talk about
one.
No, we can hang on here for the next half hour.
Yeah. One, to be single and female and date Carrington.
That
would be...
Play your cards right. Scavenger hunt's going on right now.
If my wife, when we were dating, had been abducted by pirates and taken me on a grand adventure, I would have absolutely loved it. We certainly had our own little adventure dating and everything, but there were no grand gestures, no like holding the boombox and at night in the front yard, or you know, being chased by pirates. That was, you know, we met online and we were both, you know, compatible, and it went really well.
But would you have bought into it on the second date?
Probably, having survived a first date with Carrington, I think anyone that can survive a first date with anyone, and then has the gumption to go for a second date, is, you know, you're game for whatever at that point. Because first date, everyone's kind of nervous and crazy and anxious and everything, and you get to see the worst in people sometimes. And but yeah, and then you agree to a second date, and then you just, you know, she dropped the ball, she missed out.
I think it's just that's a sign. Like, all of us have had this. That's just a sign of incompatibility. I want a relationship with UFO abductions and pirate attacks and scavenger hunts and those things. And if somebody doesn't want that, then that's cool. We're not a good match. Better find out early, right? So maybe find out early with less expense and a smaller cast. 30 people looking at you. Like, oh,
I suppose
that's
any
well,
date
huh?
that you have a cast.
Which brings me to my second point.
Yeah.
The second thing. So what did you do the rest of that night with all the other stuff that you guys had set up?
Oh, just everyone wraps it up and whatever. Like, it's just, you know, go big or go home. Or in this case, go big and then
go
home.
Yeah.
But everyone does that. But small things work out well. My latest date, which was a success, hopefully, if you're listening, we went to a bookstore and wrote little notes to people who would buy books and acted as spies and put them in as little notes inside books that you put back on the shelf. So little tiny things, so people would buy a book, open it up, oh my goodness, and we would comment on the book. It would be a book that, so we got to know each other through the books that we love and left notes about that thing to future buyers of the books.
Where is the camera crew that follows you around? Where do they hide? Because this...
In the kitchen while the pirate attacks.
I would watch that show.
I would watch
Dating Life of Carrington. And reality show or scripted or not, that would
doesn't
be
get renewed.
I mean, come on, like, you're teaching strangers to rumba with a scoreboard behind you. I mean, that's entertainment.
But
that's not a date.
But
that's like,
but for the right person, yes. But okay, but we should open those to the crap. Like, everyone, you want to partner up with the person, and this is good nerd stuff. Nerds who are listening, you gotta mesh, right? I am big and loud and full on Carrington, right? So I need to couple up with somebody who's good with that. But everyone's got their own pace, and I can be, let's face it, a little bit exhausting. Little. Teeny.
Can you? Can you really?
Challenge accepted. Okay, but let's open up to the crowd. Like, what about everybody else? Let's talk.
Nobody can top that.
My goodness. Come on, guys.
We're nerds.
How about the nerds?
Sorry. I can't even come close. I'm surprised that you didn't have any indicators on the first date. You must have really been holding back.
No, but also first date, I think everyone should get a pass on a first date. Nobody, you don't know a person on a first date.
So are you saying you always go on a second date?
Yeah, unless it goes like horribly wrong. Sure, because it's whatever. That's just the first date. Like, don't you all do that? Like, it's just first date, everyone's nervous.
Yeah,
no one's really themselves.
No, I've been given
that's when you determine serial killer status or not.
No, I've been given that advice, but some of the women that are friends of mine have told me that it's very misleading. If you ask somebody on a second date, they think that the first date went really well.
Well, yeah, I've probably asked on a second date for the same reason I asked on the first date. I'm still interested, and if you don't hit it off, then sure, don't go on a second date, but whatever. This is an odd podcast.
How about this? Just a quick question around the circle. How many of us are in a relationship, married or not, but in a relationship where you're no longer dating, no longer having to go out and...
First off, I'm so glad I'm not in the dating pool that Carrington is in.
Have we quantified that? No.
Which pool is in?
I don't know. Why would you be in a relationship and not dating?
Well,
I mean, not dating other people. Sure.
Or people,
whatever.
But what I mean is to say you're not still looking for another person.
Oh, yeah. See, what you want to show hands or something?
I'm just, you know, curious as to where in that timeline of things people.
Yeah, tomorrow is my 22nd wedding anniversary, for which I will be at Kansas Fest. Love you, honey. I know you're not listening to this.
See, that's a success story.
That is a successful relationship.
Yeah. So I haven't had to date in a long time. I only ever dated three people,
you read my memoir, because you, I can see you. I've only ever dated three people, and I married the third one, so I was going to say I wasn't good at it, but I guess on the third try, I got it right, so maybe I was good at it.
I had a very similar experience. It was just, you know, three people, married the third one, and here I am 20-something years later. Yeah. Same exact story.
I mean, I guess one possible question that we could be asking is so the reason that we're all here, recording and in this place, has something to do with, like, liking old computers and possibly collecting them and kind of being fascinated with how they used to be. And, I mean, I guess one aspect of what we're talking about is, or might be, how that figures into the rest of your life when you're not here, right? I mean, like, is that part of your relationship with your, you know, spouse, significant other, or is it just, like, you know, something
else, or is it a hindrance to
finding
one?
Basically, do they put up with you your weird hobby, or do they accept and embrace your weird hobbies?
That sounds like a host topic for RCR tomorrow.
Yeah, well, I mean, it does seem like, I mean, there's at least the kind of, I don't know, cliche that you know, it's the weird hobby, but I mean, you know, it could also be the thing that is in common.
Yeah, I mean, it can work out well. Like, I actually was with somebody for several years who I met here at Kansas Fest. Mm-hmm. You know, so that was a good thing.
Until you broke my heart.
the pirates are just too much.
It was too much.
You could think of it.
Were they?
I mean, we think of it as the weird hobby thing, but, you know, I think it's important in a relationship to have time apart, you know, and you do your thing and he or she does quilting or reads books or runs marathons or whatever it is. And, you know, if you're together all the time, then that can actually be worse for a relationship.
Doris here said that. I quilt and he quilts. She quilts and he quilts.
We have the counterexample here. I mean, Lisa and Melody presented their joint project.
Right.
Protocol, and it was amazing. I mean, it definitely can be the thing that brings you together.
I think it's also helpful if the other person has a completely distinct hobby from your own, but one that's also really weird.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because then they have to give you a pass. You know, like, I went on a date with somebody who I asked her, how are you spending New Year's Eve? And she said, oh, I'm going to be making balloon animals for everybody at the homeless shelter. Like, that's her hobby, is balloon animals. And she has a whole blog about it.
I can make a snake.
Yeah, that's pretty much like me too, yeah. So.
And you said, that's it, I'm out. Balloon animals is too far.
Right. No. Oh, like that. I'm like, okay, if I ever bring up the Apple II, she's going to get it.
Mm-hmm.
But people talk about, like, what makes you a nerd, what makes you a geek, whatever. And
it's
a lot
not,
of it,
it's not what you love, it's how you love it.
Exactly.
Yep.
It's the non-ironic passion for things.
Yep.
Yes.
So I think if somebody can get into non-ironically being enthusiastically and passionate about whatever,
right,
they're going to get that you do the same thing.
Yep.
About your stuff.
Yeah. Cool.
We've fixed nerddom.
Yay. Well, on that note, this has been another successful episode of Chicken Missile. This is the third annual MegaCast that we've done here at Kansas Fest, and since they have announced there will be another Kansas Fest, I assume there will be another MegaCast. But to wrap up this one, let's go once more around the circle and announce our names in the podcast, so if listeners want to tune in to any particular voices they heard in the past hour and a half, they'll know where to find us. Paul?
I'm Paul. I'm on Retro Competing Roundtable and also half of Drop 3 Inches. All of these will be in the show notes.
I'm Carrington, also on the RCR, and apparently Carrington's Nerd Love podcast.
Yeah.
And I'm Quinn from Open Apple, the one and only official Apple II podcast.
Not the first.
Jeff Salzman from historyofpersonalcomputing.com.
And this is Charles from the How To podcast, which is also about the Apple II. You'll hear my voice and usually see my hands and arms up to the elbows, but not my face in most of my videos.
So you don't have to come to Kansas Fest to see that.
Yeah, and you can find it on retroconnector.com.
I'm Todd George from the Chicken Lips Radio podcast, which is a Commodore podcast about general Commodore computing, not specific to music or games, which is well covered by other podcasts.
I'm John Leake from RetroMatcast, co-host for that, and you can find us on RetroMatcast.com.
And can you do your Alf impression for us?
Oh, again? Ha! Willie! Ha!
Thank you.
And Michael, what can you do?
You should save that for second. We're going to cut everything
out. Hold that an impression?
And I'm Mike Mulhern from the Retro Computing Roundtable, where you'll hear everything about Apple first.
Nice.
It's true. It's true.
I'm Rob from the Player Missile Podcast, where we talk about Atari stuff.
Stuff.
Kevin from Antic, where we talk about Atari stuff. AtariPodcast.com.
And interviews.
And interviews.
And interviews. 2 days.
Is that how often you record them, or how often you air them?
Air them every 2 days.
And I'm Ken from Retro Computing Roundtable, Polygamer, and Indie Cider. This has been Chicken Missile, and thank you for listening.
This has been the Open Apple Podcast. Subscribe to us in iTunes or visit us at open-apple.net, where you can browse our extensive catalogue of past episodes or read our blog. If you like what you've heard today, or even if you didn't, your comments, questions, or ideas are always welcome. Send them to feedback@open-apple.net.